Morning everyone, welcome to Online Church with Grace and Truth. My name is Deborah and it's wonderful to share this Sunday morning with you once again. Hope you enjoyed last week's meet of Peter all the way from the first century, and today we will be continuing our exploration of some biblical characters and examining their lives. Today, no different, we will be examining Christmas through the eyes of Joseph. But before we do, let's quieten down our hearts to worship our Lord God together through song and prayer. Singing whilst we are singing music worship together, or if you're a musician, you can also film and record yourself likewise. Our editing team can then just take your video or your recording and then add it to our music video. And how exciting would it be if we can all be a part of that? We might not be able to meet up physically together to sing together, But this might be an interesting and exciting way that we can kind of digitally sing and worship our Lord God together. If you don't feel like you have an amazing singing voice, don't let that put you off. We really believe that our Lord God delights when his people are together worshiping him, and we would love to hear your voice. I'll see you singing together with us next week. If this sounds like something you might be interested in, send us an email or send your clip to the email just below. We'd love to hear from you.
Hi everyone, this is Pastor Apostolos. I'm really excited to announce that due to a relaxation of COVID restrictions, our church will be resuming our physical Sunday gatherings on Sunday, the 27th of December. Our church details are on the screen for you to see. We will be meeting at the Lions Club Hall at 42A Ross Street, North Parramatta, starting at 9:30 a.m. Can you believe it? It's been more than 8 months since we've met together in one place. So I'm sure that you are all missing each other. So it's great that we can finally worship the Lord together this Christmas. But of course, we're going to need to do it in a COVID-safe way. So if you do intend to come, please make sure you do the following. First, if you are displaying any COVID symptoms such as fever or sore cough, or runny nose, please stay home to play it safe. Second, please wear a mask when you come. Third, someone will be checking your temperature upon entering and asking you to register your name and contact details. Fourth, please clean your hands with the provided hand sanitizer upon entry. And number five, please make sure you maintain a 1.5 meter social distance from people as far as possible. Even though the COVID situation has improved, we know that the virus is still out there. And so as a church, we just want to be responsible in minimizing the risk of any possible COVID-19 transmission. If you recently joined our church through our online service, we would love for you to come along to our Sunday gatherings so that we can meet you in person. But if due to geographical distance, that's not possible, that's okay, because we will be continuing our online services so that you won't be missing out. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact our church at graceandtruthchurchau@gmail.com. And I look forward to seeing all of you on Sunday, the 27th of December. Hi everyone, this is Pastor Apostolos. So wonderful to see you this Sunday. Well, it's that time of the year where people start putting up Christmas trees, invite their friends and family over, and go on a shopping spree. Yes, the Christmas season has arrived. And after an unprecedented year of COVID-19, lockdowns, and other once-in-a-century events, this coming Christmas is certainly going to be a memorable one, isn't it? Last week, the government announced a further easing of COVID restrictions, and everyone were celebrating because we can finally now have a normal Christmas. But here's a question for you. If, let's say, the shops and restaurants are still closed, there is no carols by the domain, and people are not allowed to go out of their homes, would that mean we would not be able to have a normal Christmas? What is Christmas all about, really? What is the meaning behind Christmas? Well, who better to tell us what Christmas is really all about than the people who were there that very first Christmas 2000 years ago? And I'm really excited to let you know that through a recent invention, a time machine, our church has been able to contact several characters from the past. And so for the next few weeks, we are going to have characters from the Christmas story share what really happened that very first Christmas. And today, our special guest will be Joseph, the husband of Mary. So please put your hands together to welcome Joseph, the husband of Mary. Shalom, God's peace be with you. My name is Yosef, or Joseph, as you would probably know me in the English language. I am the husband of Mary. Your pastor tells me that you will be celebrating Christmas very soon. And so he's asked me to share with you what happened on that very first Christmas. I noticed on my way coming here that Christmas is a very festive and glamorous occasion for you guys. I see a lot of beautiful decorations and elaborate settings, which look spectacular, I must say. It's almost as if you have romanticized the story of Mary and I. Your artists have made us look larger than life with a halo around our heads and a mystical expression on our faces. They make the story of Mary and I sound more like a fairy tale than an actual historical event that really happened. But Mary and I are not larger than life. We are just plain, ordinary people with humble backgrounds. I work as a carpenter, just as my father and my grandfather worked as a carpenter. In my days, carpenters were regarded as lower class, as most of us were illiterate and uneducated. That is why when Jesus went to speak at a synagogue in my hometown on one occasion, the people were offended. "Isn't this the carpenter's son?" they said. "Where then does he get all these things from?" They would not believe in him because they knew his family background. As a carpenter, I don't earn very much, but it's enough to feed my family. But even though I come from a humble background, I'm proud to say that I have a bit of royal blood in me. You see, my great-great-great-great-great-great 25 greats grandfather happens to be King David, the greatest king Israel had ever had. And being a descendant of David is a big deal because our prophets had foretold that one day the future Messiah who will come to save our people will come from the line of David. Maybe that is why God chose Mary and I to be the parents of his son, Jesus, because both of us come from the line of David. Our people have been waiting centuries for the coming of the Messiah. I understand that many Jews in your time are still waiting for the Messiah, which is a shame because if they knew how Jesus was born, they would know that the Messiah has already come. So let me tell you the story of how Jesus was born. It really is an incredible story. Mary and I were engaged at the time. Both of us were in our early teens. You may think that that's very young to get married, but in our culture, that was common. Girls would normally get married between the ages of 12 and 14, and the boys a few years older, between the ages of 18 and 20. In our culture, a Hebrew wedding was divided into two stages. The first stage was what we called the Kedusha. This was a period of engagement that would last for up to a year. I understand that couples in your culture also get engaged before they get married. But if you don't mind me saying it, we took engagement a lot more seriously than you do. In our culture, an engagement was as legally binding as marriage itself. People already considered Mary and I to be husband and wife. And the only way to break off an engagement was by filing for a divorce. During this year of engagement, the couple would live in separate homes and were not allowed to have any private contact with each other. The second stage of a Hebrew marriage is what we call the huppah. And the huppah was where the marriage would get consummated. It is kind of like the wedding ceremonies that you have, only we did it a lot better than you guys. Our wedding ceremony would not go for just one day, it would go for 7 days, and the whole village would be invited. We would dance and feast until the full 7 days was over. Well, I was counting down the days to our wedding ceremony because I loved Mary. And I just could not wait for that day when I could take her home to be my wife. I would daydream about how beautiful she would look on our wedding day, the foods we would get to eat and the friends we would meet. So you can imagine how shattered I was when Mary came to me one day and said two words, "I'm pregnant." And then she went on to explain how some angel had appeared to her, telling her that she would become pregnant by the Holy Spirit and that the baby will be called the Son of the Most High. Now, if you were me, how would you respond? Would you go, "Wow, that's fantastic news, Mary. I believe you." Absolutely not. I was devastated. I was angry. I said to Mary, "How could you? You know, who do you take me for? The child in you is conceived by the Holy Spirit." Yeah, right. Tell me, who is the real father? Wait till I get my hands on him. My world came crashing down that day. My heart was broken into a million pieces. I felt betrayed. Even though I knew that premarital infidelity was something out of character for Mary because she was someone who feared the Lord, the facts were there. She was pregnant. And you have to understand what a serious matter this was in my culture. In my culture, a woman caught in adultery could be stoned to death. At best, she would be shamed for the rest of her life. And she would not be able to find a husband to support her. And so I was in a big dilemma. If I divorced Mary, I would essentially ruin her for the rest of her life, which I did not want to do because even though I thought she had cheated on me, I still loved her. But as a man of integrity who feared God, I just in good conscience could not marry her. And so after a lot of deliberation and inner conflict, I eventually made up my mind to divorce her privately. That way, she would not be subject to public disgrace. But on that night, an angel appeared to me in a dream. I was petrified. The light was so blinding that I could not look directly at him. And the angel said to me, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. The baby inside of her is from the Holy Spirit. She is going to have a son. You must give him the name Jesus. That's because he will save his people from their sins." After the angel finished saying those words, I woke up from my dream, full of joy. Mary was telling the truth after all. The baby inside of her really is conceived by the Holy Spirit. At that moment, a scripture from the Old Testament flashed into my mind. 700 years earlier, the prophet Isaiah had prophesied concerning the Messiah that the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin is going to have a baby. She will give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. And then it all made sense to me. Mary is that virgin. The baby inside of her is the promised Messiah that we Jews have been waiting centuries for to save God's people. Isn't that incredible that God would personally come down from heaven to save mankind by being born as a baby? And what a great privilege that Mary and I, of all people, would get to be the mother and stepfather of God's Son. I felt so honored. But I also knew that life would not be easy for Mary from now on. Because think about it. Who on earth is going to believe that the baby inside of her was conceived by the Holy Spirit? Everyone is going to be saying that she had committed adultery before marriage. The birth of Jesus will be seen as a big scandal. It will be the talk of the town. And if I married her, everyone will assume it was me who got Mary pregnant before the wedding day. But even though I knew that I would be bringing shame and dishonor to my family if I was to marry Mary, I wanted to protect her. And so we went forward with our wedding day and I took her home to be my wife. But dealing with the gossip and slander was not the only difficulty that Mary and I had to overcome. 8 months into Mary's pregnancy, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that there should be a census taken throughout the whole Roman world for taxation purposes. And so Mary and I had no choice but to leave Nazareth to go to Bethlehem to register for the census, because Bethlehem was the place where I was born. But do you know how long it takes to go from Nazareth to Bethlehem by foot? 7 days. And don't forget, Mary was pregnant at the time. The baby could come out at any moment. I was praying so hard throughout our journey that Mary would not go into labor until we reached our destination. Well, thank God, we managed to arrive in Bethlehem safe and sound. But when we arrived there was no guest room available for us to stay in. because so many people were coming into Bethlehem for the census that there was no room. While we were still looking for a place to stay in, it happened. Mary's water broke. She went into labor, and I began to panic. I frantically knocked on every door, begging people, "Please, please, my wife is about to give birth. Please give us a room to stay in for the night." But person after person just slammed the door in front of my face. Until finally, one kind innkeeper took pity on us and told us he had a place available. But what he showed us was not what is in your Christmas cards. It was a cold, dark cave used for housing animals. We saw a few cattle grazing on one corner, a few sheep on the other corner, and then one or two donkeys on this corner, and chickens running all over the place. And of course, there was quite a lot of animal, you know what, scattered all about the floor. But we were desperate, and so we said, "That will do." And there, in that dark, cold cave, Mary gave birth to Jesus Christ. She wrapped him in cloths to keep him warm and placed him in a manger. And there he was, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, homeless in his first night on earth, lying not in a crib, but in a trough used for feeding animals. It seemed so inappropriate to me that the Son of God's first breath would be the stench of animals. I wondered to myself, why, God? Why would you allow your own son to be born in such a lowly place like this? This is not how a king deserves to be treated. And then I remembered a prophecy that the prophet Isaiah had said in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 3. The ox knows its master, the donkey its owner's manger, but Israel does not know. My people do not understand. Even Jesus being born in a manger was a fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. God used a manger to make the point that even the animals recognize the presence of the Lord. And yet, so many people in my culture and in your culture do not recognize Jesus to be the Son of God, even in Christmas. Jesus's first night on earth would be prophetic of how he would be treated by those he had come to save. Rejected, unwelcomed, and ignored. But there were a few people who recognized Jesus to be the Messiah. On the night Jesus was born, a few shepherds came to worship him. They told us that some angel had appeared to them, saying that the Savior of the world has been born. A few months after, a few wise men from the east also came to worship Jesus by following a star in the sky. I understand that your pastor has invited them to speak to you in the next 2 weeks, so you will get to hear their side of the story. After the wise men left to return to their home country, however, an angel appeared to me a second time. This time, however, there was a different feeling to it. "Get up, Joseph," the angel said. "Take Mary and the child and flee to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, because Herod is searching for the child to kill him." I had heard a lot of terrible stories about King Herod. He was the ruler of Judea at the time, and he was a ruthless tyrant. He murdered anyone who he saw as a threat to his power, even his own wife and his own sons. In fact, we would often joke that it was better to be one of Herod's pigs than to be his son. If Herod was after Jesus, then that's bad news. And so we immediately packed everything and left for Egypt. A short while later, I heard the report from someone that King Herod had ordered all the boys in Bethlehem of the ages 2 and under to be slaughtered because he was afraid that some baby in the vicinity of Bethlehem would one day take away his throne from him. It was a terrible massacre. But through the intervention of God, Herod was not able to lay a finger on Jesus. And so for the first 2 years of Jesus' life, we had to live as refugees in the land of Egypt. Life was not easy for us. We had no home of our own. We did not know the language. The people treated us as aliens. I would often wonder to myself why God would allow his son to have such a difficult life. That is not how I imagined life would be for someone who is supposed to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Like everyone else, I had assumed that when the Messiah comes, he will come with glory and power. But here we were, living as refugees in a foreign land, running for our lives. We ended up having to live in Egypt for about 2 years until an angel appeared again to me to tell us that it was safe for us to go back home. And that's the story of Jesus' birth, my dear friends. It's not quite the fairy tale that many of you make it out to be, isn't it? I hope that from my story, you now have a better understanding of what Christmas is really all about. And before I go, I would just like to leave you with three important truths for you to remember this Christmas. The first truth is that God exalts the humble. God exalts the humble. The real Christmas story was not a glamorous one. There was no gold and glitter. Jesus was born in humble circumstances. He was not born in a palace. He was born in a manger. Why did God choose such a lowly place for his son to be born into? To demonstrate that God exalts the humble. Philippians chapter 3, verses 5 to 11 says, "In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Amen. Amen. I suppose that is why God chose me to be the stepfather of Jesus, because I am just a humble carpenter. Luke chapter 14, verse 11 says, "For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." So why not use this Christmas to learn humility? Because that is the true spirit of Christmas. Christ humbled himself to serve us. So in the same way, we too must humble ourselves to serve others. So have a think about who you can serve this Christmas. It might be mowing the lawn for a neighbor, or cooking for someone who is going through a difficult time, or feeding a homeless person on the street. For God exalts the humble. Second, God is with us. God is with us. God is not some distant, unapproachable God who has no concern for our well-being or welfare. He is a personal God who desires to have a relationship with you and me. So personal, in fact, that he came all the way from heaven into our world to dwell amongst us in person through Jesus Christ. That is why the virgin birth is so important. I understand that many people today do not believe in the virgin birth. They think that it is just a myth. But if God is God, then surely nothing is impossible for him. The virgin birth is crucial to the Christmas story because it proves that Jesus really is Emmanuel, God with us. The virgin birth is important because it is the only way that Jesus could be both fully God and fully man at the same time. Jesus was a normal human being, just like you and me. But he was not born with the sinful nature that has been passed down to all humanity from Adam. And as the Son of God, both fully God and fully man, Jesus is the only one able to die for the sins of the entire world. Is that not amazing? That God would personally come from heaven into the muck and mire of our world to dwell amongst us, and not just that, to die for us. That is how much he loves you and me. So if you are feeling a bit lonely this Christmas, if you feel that you are all alone, know that you are never alone. Emmanuel, God, is with you. And he sent his son Jesus into our world 2,000 years ago to prove that to you. Third, God blesses those who obey in faith. I don't know why God chose me to be the stepfather of his son. There's nothing extraordinary about me. The only thing extraordinary about me, perhaps, is my faith. From my story, you can see that it was not an easy decision for me to take Mary to be my wife. I knew that to do so would come at a heavy price. It would bring shame and ridicule to me and my family. But I am the kind of guy that if God tells me to do something, I will do it, no matter how hard or difficult or impossible it may seem to be. And because I was a man of faith, God blessed me with the awesome privilege of being the stepfather to his own son, Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says that without faith, it is impossible to please God. And the same goes for you, my dear friends. If you want to receive the gift of salvation that Jesus offers, you must put your faith in Him. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, so that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. And that, my dear friends, can I say, is the real gift of Christmas, the gift of eternal life. And how do you receive this gift of eternal life? By believing in God's Son, Jesus Christ. So have you received God's gift of salvation yet? If not, why not put your faith in Jesus Christ today? And if you have already believed in Jesus Christ, then my encouragement to you this Christmas is keep walking in faith, because God blesses those who obey in faith. Thank you for listening to my story. God be with you all this Christmas.
This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the law has said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate the marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Look. Savior is born.
Formal meeting for this morning. What a different view of Christmas. These days in the lead up, there's a lot of hype, a lot of lunches, dinners, the shopping malls are filled. But what a different view of Christmas through the eyes of Joseph. Think about this as we head into the Christmas season and what the real meaning of Christmas is. Until then, we're still meeting online. So we'll see you next week. For those who'd like to continue supporting God's ministry through Grace and Truth Church, the financial details will be on the next page. And as always, let's continue to pray together. And for those who have not yet, we are also still meeting in small connect groups. Just email this link underneath if you'd like to get connected. Until then, we'll see you next week.